Hello everyone. Everyone's favorite cluster is back, and it's bigger than ever. These guys here are my $250 hyper-converged Proxmox and Ceph cluster, and they're getting a new best friend today, some spinning rust. So today we are going to talk about a number of topics more advanced in the Proxmox and RADOS block device system, such as mixing solid-state drives along with hard drives, changing the failure domain. This thing is the only node that has hard drives, so if we want to store data on hard drives, then we're going to have to tolerate the fact that if this node goes down, we're going to lose all of those pools. And we're also going to talk about SSD accelerated pools for virtual machines, using separate metadata and data pools. I'm still just focusing on RBD, or RADOS Block Device, for this video. That's the underlying storage you use for virtual machines and containers. We're not going to talk about CephFS, the file system, yet, but I'll get to it eventually, I promise. So come along with me on this journey as we explore the ins and outs of Proxmox pools, metadata, data, all of that fun stuff. So since the last video, I reinstalled everything. So I'm now running Proxmox 7.3. And I added big store to the cluster. So that is the HP microserver. I already have the three thin clients. That makes four. So I am going to speed run setting up the Ceph cluster. And if you haven't watched my previous video, go up there and watch that. I'll show in detail in that video how to set up Ceph. Okay, so we're back to roughly where we were at the end of the last video. So I have my four nodes there in a Proxmox cluster. I've installed Ceph on top. I'm using Ceph 17 this time because it came out since my last video. And I've added all my OSDs. So my three thin client nodes each have their 128 gig flash drive. So that's OSD 0, 1, and 2. And then my big store has four hard drives, which are 2 terabytes each, and the almost half terabyte SSD. So that's all I've done so far. I've added the OSDs. I added the manager, which is here. And we're going to use the manager today to play with things. So in the previous video, when I told you to add pools, we came here. We went to Proxmox, Ceph, pools, create. And we created our pool with a size of 3. But there's more to it than just what Proxmox gives us. So instead of creating our pools in Proxmox, we're going to use the Ceph management GUI instead, because it has a lot more options. So we see basically the same information here. So I have four nodes running monitors. I have one running a manager. You don't need a manager in every node. We're not doing file systems. And we go to pools, and we have the manager pool. So this is where we're going to go in the Ceph side to create pools. So we can click create, and we see a lot more options here. We can say erasure coded or replicated. We can add applications. We can choose different options. And so this is how we're going to manage our pools now when we're doing fancier things.
Now is probably a good time to introduce failure domains. You can think of the failure domain as the level at which Ceph will implement the redundancy we've requested. In a traditional RAID or ZFS system, you're probably used to building a single system and designing for the failure of individual drives. In Ceph, that would correspond to the OSD failure domain, since one OSD is usually equivalent to one drive. This tells Ceph that it needs to put the redundant data on separate OSDs, so a failed OSD doesn't cause us to lose data. By default, the next level up from OSD is host. This tells Ceph that we not only need to keep redundant data on separate drives, but entirely separate hosts. Configuring this means we can now lose an entire server, or more depending on what our redundancy rules are, and continue operating. This is quite powerful for high availability systems, as now we can get high availability storage as we would with high availability virtual machines. If you build larger clusters or have a need for more fine-grained failure domains, you're free to create more, such as a shared chassis system, a rack, an aisle, etc. But that's out of the scope of this video.
So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to add a rule that forces stuff to be stored only on SSDs. So for whatever reason, we want to store our VM disks on SSDs. Maybe we want our boot drives to be on SSDs and our data drives to be on hard drives, whatever. So we're going to call this, so we give it a name, we can name whatever we want. Pool type is going to be replicated, which is the same as we were doing before, and our replicated sizes of 3. So this will give us the same configuration we had in Proxmox in the last video, which means that all the data will be spread across 3 chunks, and a minimum of two of them will be required. Next, we have to add an application, and our application is usually going to be RBD, which is RADOS Block Device. That is what we use for virtual machine disks and anything that emulates a hard drive. And then we're going to create a new rule here instead of just using replicated rule. And we're going to call this SSD rule. We'll call this replicated SSD rule. Failure domain can either be OSD or host. And device class, we're going to say let Ceph decide, or we can say SSD. So with this rule in place, it's saying that whatever we put on this pool using this rule must be stored on separate hosts and must be stored in SSDs. There we go. And create pool. So now we have a pool. It's creating it. It is a replica for RBD. And we come over into Proxmox and add that as a storage. So data center, storage, add RBD. So it already found it because it's the only one here. ProxLab SSD. And we're going to let it be used for disks, images, and containers. And let's go.
So you might have noticed that our storage efficiency isn't great so far. Storage efficiency is the percentage of our raw disk capacity that we are actually able to use. With our 3x replicated pools, we are keeping 3 copies of all of our data. This is fantastic for redundancy, but unfortunately it means our storage efficiency is only 33%. You might compare this to using a RAID 1 with 3 disks in a mirror. Thankfully, Ceph has a solution to this, erasure coding. You can think of this similarly to RAID 5 and higher RAID levels, although it's much more flexible in Ceph. With erasure coding, we take the original data block and we split it up into multiple shards. Then, using an algorithm known as Reed-Solomon coding, we compute additional shards containing error-correcting information. As long as we have the original number of shards in good condition, in any combination of original shards and error-correcting shards, we can recompute the entire original data block. The number of shards to break the data into is known as K, and the number of additional error-correcting shards is known as M. The total storage efficiency is K divided by K plus M. We require at least K plus M separate nodes in our chosen failure domain, and we can tolerate the failure of up to M of those nodes. In larger clusters, we can use very wide erasure codes, such as 10 plus 4, to have good storage efficiency and still tolerate the failure of 4 nodes. In small clusters, we can use the minimum code of 2 plus 1 to get 66% storage efficiency and the ability to tolerate the failure of a single node.
So we're going to create an erasure-coded pool now. We're going to call it ProxLab Erasure. Make it an erasure-coded pool. We need to check EC overwrites if we're using either RBD or CephFS. If you're using RGW, RADOS Gateway, then you don't need to use EC overwrites. And our application is going to be RBD again. We're going to make a new profile. So if I want to create this on just my hard drives, the most I can do would be a 3 plus 1, which means I can tolerate one drive failure, or I could do a 2 plus 2, which means I can tolerate two drive failures. I'm going to do a 3 plus 1, because I like to live dangerously. So yeah, let's get on with this. So failure domain I'm going to say is OSD, because all of my hard drives are in the same OSD, and device class, we're going to say HDD. Which means we have 4 OSDs. We're using a 2 plus 1 erasure code. Let's go. So what happens if we try to add this guy into Proxmox? So we're going to go data center, storage, add, RBD. Well, it lets us pick it. What happens if we try to use it? It's a trick question, but why I'm asking you guys. I'll pick the same settings as the other one. Ubuntu desktop, vert IO block with discard. Yeah, so we got an error. And the error says, blah, 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 blah. Unable to create RBD. Operation not supported. So why is that? If we go to the documentation here, it says, Erasure code of pools do not support OMAP, so to use them with RBD, you must instruct them to store their data in an erasure-coded pool and their metadata in a replicated pool. This means using the erasure-coded pool as the data pool. So we're going to do that. So any pool will work as our metadata pool. It just has to be replicated. And any data will work, and any pool will work as our data pool with any settings, as long as it has allow EC overwrites on if it's erasure-coded. So if I go here, where we had the error. Well, we got to delete it because it's not working. So we'll add a new one for RBD. Proc slab erasure. But I need to pick a pool here that is actually going to store the metadata, because whatever I pick here in the GUI is what's going to store my metadata, not my data. So I'm going to pick the SSD pool. And I already have VMs in that pool, and it's fine for these to share. I just need to pick a pool that is replicated. So we're going to pick the SSD pool and add it. Now, if we were to just use this as is, it would still be storing our data on the SSD pool, which is not what we want. So we need to go into the config file and tell Proxmox where the data pool is, where it should actually put the data, which is our proxlab erasure. So we're going to go to the shell and we're going to edit a file. etc/pve/storage.cfg. So this file is all of the storage we have in Proxmox. So I have my NAS, which I use for ISO images. I have local, which comes in by default. I have proxlab SSD, which we added. I have proxlab erasure, which we added. So here we see the pool field is proxlab SSD. And if we go back to the Ceph documentation, it told us we need to have a data pool. And so the data pool needs to be our erasure coded pool, which in this case is named proxlab erasure. So I'm going to copy that name. And we're going to add a new field to this file. So we're going to tab over and say data pool proxlab erasure. And we will save that. So now every time we try to store something on proxlab erasure, it's going to store the metadata about the existence of the volume, etc., on our SSD pool. But the actual blocks of data are going to get stored in our erasure coded pool. So if I try to create that VM 301 again, looks like we were. There were no errors.
So I hope you guys enjoyed that walkthrough of fäncy pools in Ceph, at least fäncy for RADOS Block Device. For the curious, I ran through the full Ubuntu desktop installer on both of my virtual machines, the replicated pool and the erasure-coded pool. Both of them came out to 11.4 gigabytes of VM storage space, which for the replicated pool meant it took 3 times that, and for the erasure-coded pool, as expected, it took 1.5 times that. I also looked at how much metadata it was using, and the metadata was only 2 kilobytes for that. So you don't need much space in your metadata pool, at least not for RBD. So next up in the series, I'm planning on diving into CephFS, the file system. And man, is that a big topic. Much more complicated than RADOS Block Device, that's why we did RBD first. There is one topic I know I'm going to get questions about, so I'm going to address it right away, and that is cache tiering. Yes, Ceph does support cache tiering of pools. Yes, you can use them for RBD, but the documentation suggests that it's not a great use case, and they have some reasons why if you read the documentation. So I'm going to leave cache tiering for a future video, probably on RADOS Gateway or CephFS. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe for all my future videos, especially that CephFS content I've mentioned that's coming up eventually, someday when I get around to it. I have a Discord server down below, which you can find if you'd like to chat with me, any questions about any of this. I have a website, feel free to read it, and as always, I will see you on the next adventure.